Good evening, everyone. Welcome to the May 9th Town Board. We have a regular meeting, a workshop, and a public hearing on the agenda. Please join me while we pledge allegiance to the flag.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, before we open the public hearing, I'm just going to ask the town attorney to review the proposed local law D that's pertaining to one and two family dwellings. So, Warren?
Basically, this local law was proposed, and we discussed it at length when we first accepted the law for purposes of commencing the local law adoption process, to address a loophole in our current zoning law where multifamily houses, three-family houses or more on a single lot, or condominiums or those types of developments actually require a site plan under our law. And we have our town code, the zoning portion of it permits more than one principal use on a single lot. That's not the way many other municipalities have their code. So in Hyde Park, you're actually permitted to, if you have a large enough lot and you can meet the bulk area requirements, you can situate several single family houses on a single lot, which would not be permissible, say, in Rhinebeck or other jurisdictions. And you would not have to undergo site plan approval or special use approval, as the case may be. And same goes for two-family houses. So you can put one or more two-family houses on a single lot and have a series of two-family houses, which again evade the site plan review requirements of our law. Whereas if you were only allowed one principal use on a lot, or if we required site plan approval for those types of two-family houses, the planning board would get to weigh in on certain aspects of the development to make sure that it doesn't have an adverse effect on neighboring properties. So this was designed to close that loophole so that if you propose to site one or more two-family houses, we call them duplexes, on a single lot in the town, you would have to go undergo site plan review and approval. And if you propose to site more than one single-family house on a lot, this local law now requires that you go and get site plan approval. And whatever that process would be, it would be up to our zoning law and to our planning board in reviewing the proposal. And we've also provided that, because we do want to encourage affordable housing in the town, and we'd like to see two-family houses sited. It's a good way to provide for affordable housing. We didn't want to have the recreation fee, which is the what we call commonly the recreation fee, but it's an impact fee that's provided for in New York State town law and our code, where if you're proposing a subdivision or a site plan in the town, the planning board is required to go through a process of determining whether that project will have an impact on the available recreation or park land resources in the town. And if it does, the planning board, if the site can accommodate it, would require that recreation or parkland be set aside on that development. But in many cases, there's no room, or the sites are too small, and they wouldn't accommodate a parkland or recreation resources. So the law allows then for the planning board to charge a fee in lieu of providing those services. And there's an analysis that the planning board would go through before determining that fee in lieu of, and ultimately, that could result in the imposition of a recreation fee. But our law specifically requires, provides that if it's four dwelling units or less on a single lot, so if it'd be two duplexes or less, or if it would be four single-family units or less, we're exempting those applications from the recreation fee requirement. So we put this law out there. We have a public hearing tonight. We sent it to the county for their approval as required by law. And we did get a comment back from the county in which they had one concern over the law, and that is that they would like to exclude the site plan approval requirement for the placement of one two-family house on a lot. And their rationale is that this would further encourage affordable housing. In all other respects, they are supportive of the change in the local law. However, because that they've made this comment and they've actually indicated that they want the town to change the law in this regard, we're going to have to internally review the recommendations of the county to see whether we want to move forward with the law in its present form or whether we want to amend the local law to accommodate the county's suggestions. We also got a comment back from the planning board, which appears to recommend adoption of the law, although there were some comments in there about recreation fees, which I have to kind of look at. I only just got this about a minute ago. So that would be another reason for me to take a look at our planning board's comments, although they were supportive of the law. So with that in mind, we're going to open up the public hearing tonight, but we're not going to close the public hearing. We are going to internally consider the recommendations, and it's quite possible that we may come back at the next meeting with a revised local law to accommodate the county and to what extent we need to take a look at the comments of the planning board if that requires any tweaks in the law. I don't think it does, but that may be possible. So the public comments tonight should keep in mind that we're going to keep the public hearing open after this public hearing tonight and extend that to the next town board meeting.
Great.
Any questions?
Yeah, that's
okay. I'm also going to defer. We did adopt a part one of the environmental assessment form at an earlier meeting. I had intended on going through the part two. We used the short form, but I think we're going to wait on that until we get public comments and until we see what the local law is going to look like in its final form. So that would also be deferred to the next meeting.
Okay, I think that's a good recap of the process and how we arrived here. You know, basically what we're attempting to do is, as Warren said, close the loophole, be fair, make sure that we cover our bases, and actually achieve the goal of having the same standards apply to multifamily housing because on a single lot. And so, as Warren said, we did receive comments from both the planning board and our zoning administrator and the county. And because of that, we're going to leave the public hearing open. So I did forget to ask to have the minutes approved. So may I have a motion to do so?
Motion.
And a second?
Second.
And all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay. So with that, I would like to have a motion to open the public hearing on proposed local law D. Madam Clerk, would you please read the notice?
Please take notice that the Town of Hyde Park Town Board will conduct a public hearing on proposed local law D of the year 2016, entitled Local Law Amending Chapter 108 of the Town Code relating to one family and two family dwellings. The local law will amend the town code to require site plan approval by the planning board for the placement of one or more two-family dwellings on a single lot and for the placement of more than one family dwelling on a single lot. In addition, the local law eliminates the need for reservation of parkland or payment or a sum of money in lieu of, in conjunction with the site plan approval for any development of two family or one family dwellings on a single lot, which consists of a total of four dwelling units or less. The public hearing will be held at the Town Hall, located 4383 Albany Post Road, Hyde Park, New York, at 7:05 on May 9th, 2016. All persons desiring to comment on the local law will be given an opportunity to do so at the public hearing. Copies of the proposed local law shall be available for inspection at the town clerk's office during regular business hours. By order of the Town Board of the Town of Hyde Park, dated April 19th, 2016, Hyde Park, New York, Donna McGrogan, Town Clerk.
You better.
Okay. Thank you, Madam Clerk. May I have a motion to open the public hearing?
Make a motion.
And a second?
Second.
And all in favor?
Aye.
Okay, would anyone like to come on up and speak about local law D? Nope, doesn't appear so. Then we'll have a motion to adjourn the public hearing till, yeah, and then you can, right after we finish the public hearing, David, and then speak to it. So when is our next meeting? The 23rd, I believe?
23rd.
So we will have a motion to adjourn till the 23rd and reopen it then?
I make that motion.
And a second?
Second.
And all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay, David, did you want to make a comment?
Yeah, I'm not clear on this. I have a single family dwelling on my lot. It's a pretty good sized lot.
Yeah.
So there's room for actually another unit. Now, the county is saying we should allow another duplex there. That would be three homes, though.
No,
okay.
I don't think that's what they're
saying.
I think they're saying a second
unit. A duplex.
Yep.
What the county is saying, and we just got this today also at the last minute, is that if someone is proposing to put a single duplex on a lot,
on an empty lot,
correct. That would, they suggest that should not trigger site plan review. Right. And I have to tell you, that was an issue that we internally discussed. So it's not quite a surprise to us. So we'll be discussing.
I understand that now. Okay.
Fine.
Do you have any other questions though about it? I mean, it is, you know, unless you really kind of get into the mindset of what zoning is attempting to do, it's kind of hard to understand all of it, but it seems very obtuse, really, but it's not actually. But
I wasn't trying to skirt the law, I just
no. Just want to know for the future, right,
yes,
Dave?
You can do whatever you want.
Okay, so there's more to come on this law, where it's still a work in progress.
Terrific.
Okay, so moving on, we have the MS4 report, and we have Tad and Pete here to discuss it.
Thank you. Good night.
Thank you. Good night.
Good night.
Oh, I get to sit off here.
Hey, Pete, can you grab the other mics? So that way Tad can have one as well, please. Great job.
I get it. How was that? Did I do all
you
right?
You did wonderful, man. You're a leader, you are. I'll tell you later.
Good evening, everybody.
Hi.
This is, our annual MS4. Report, which I know Emily's going to ask me to say it, but MS4 stands for Municipal Separate Stormwater System, right?
Sewer system.
Thank you. So, we've, as we're required to do every single year, we're supposed to do a report. Our reporting year goes from March to March. So over the past several months, Tad and I, and honestly, more so Tad, has been working on the report. So we finished it. It was posted on the town's website. It has to be posted on the town's website 30 days prior to whenever we're going to hold a public hearing. And then the report has to be filed with the DEC by June the 9th. So what we're here asking for, and it's number four on your resolutions, is just to have the town board set a public hearing for June the 6th, so we can see if the public has any comments on our report. It's basically just, the report is nothing more than documenting the prior year's activities, things that we, you know, have done, such as keeping track of how many erosion control permits we issued, how many stormwater permits we issued, how many stormwater pollution prevention plans that we've, you know, like reviewed as we go through the planning board like process. And there, again, there's like a host, there's a host of other things, but it's just basically updating what we've done, you know, in that, you know, year. So do you have anything to add or?
No, the town is required to address 6 minimum measures with our stormwater permit, and this outlines those 6 minimum measures and what we've accomplished.
Okay, does anyone have any questions?
There's going to be more time, obviously, to ask any questions than when we have, you know, the hearing, but, so.
It's pretty pro forma, then we're just.
For the most part.
Doing what the state requires in terms of.
Yep.
Administering the stormwater protections.
Yep, it's a process. Yep.
Okay. All right.
Sort of related topic, I just wanted to thank Joe and Tad for moving forward with the FEMA representatives to schedule a visit so we can take the next steps on the community rating system and helping people get a discount on their flood insurance.
That's good. Yeah. Okay. Well,
that's all we have for
right,
tonight,
well,
folks.
Okay.
Short and sweet.
Short and sweet. And it's always a very stimulating topic, so.
Now, it's
sorry,
important.
Sorry, I didn't have my, I'll have a lot of questions for you next time.
Really?
Okay, thanks a lot.
Detailed.
Thank you.
Site-specific stuff.
Give this back to Donna, this is the original.
Oh, okay, here's the original, Donna. Okay. So we have another item on our workshop agenda, and I can kind of just take everybody through the evolution of this vacant property law, local law. At one of the recent mayors and supervisors meetings, we had a discussion with being led by Randy Casal from Beacon, and the question was posed to him, to Randy, is, you know, how is it that Beacon has achieved so much in such a short amount of time? And his response really was, it's really been about enforcing code enforcement. It has really been allowed Beacon to make that transition from a city that was and underutilized, maybe we could say, and really just prospering. And obviously there was so many other factors going into it, you know, the proximity to the city, you have DIA, you have a typical Main Street. But, you know, Randy, really, Beacon is a tremendous success story. And so he said, oh, at the time, he's like, you really, you know, we just passed a vacant property law. And it's really been beneficial because in the city of Beacon, because you have a lot of real estate speculators, they were just kind of buying properties and warehousing them with not really doing any type of maintenance and just holding them for the future because real estate values were increasing substantially. So I thought, wow, that's such a great idea because it's one of the things that we hear so very regularly on the town board is, you know, why aren't you doing more about vacant buildings? And the reality is that it's a personal property issue, and we don't have the tools in our toolbox to make certain uses come or to improve their properties. But there is an aspect to real estate investment where by people may be sitting on them and utilizing some sort of protectionist philosophy. And so basically that is the intent of this law. And I asked Warren to take a look at Beacons and then tweak it and to come up with a law that would really fit Hyde Park because clearly we're a very different place. And I think this is the first run through, and Warren, can you kind of fill us in more on the details?
Sure. I took a look at Beacon's law, and I thought it was quite good. I used that as a prototype for the Hyde Park law, but took out certain things in the Beacon law that I did not think were applicable to the town of Hyde Park. And the law not only encourages, it will discourage, hopefully, the warehousing of vacant buildings, but it also provides a great tool for dealing with vacant buildings that become a public nuisance and violate the New York State Property and Maintenance Code. It's an additional tool to what we have. The first section, and this is just a run-through to provide the town board members with a copy of this law to let them look at it and digest it. And then what I thought we would do would come back at the next meeting and see what your reaction is. And then if this is a go, or if board members have a suggestion for change, I can put it into final law and we can start the adoption process. But just so you know, what we have here, the first section is the legislative findings and intent, the purposes of the law. We have a definition of a vacant building as any building which is not occupied or put to its intended use for more than 6 months, except in the case of a building which is unoccupied or unused due to damage caused by active guard, in which case the building shall become vacant or unused for more than 9 months. We have another section on requiring the prevention of ingress and egress so that these do not become an attractive nuisance or a danger to the community. We require the property owner to discontinue the utilities, securing accessible entryways. We prescribe a method of boarding up structures in the case of vacant buildings, the removal of debris, and perhaps the most important portion of this law is section 107.9-9, which is the registration of vacant buildings. We're now requiring, if the law is passed, the owners of vacant buildings to register with the town of Hyde Park within 90 days of the law. Otherwise, they'll be subject to penalties. And we have a list of information that we want to have concerning those properties. We also require the posting of a sign after registration along the frontage of the property containing the name of the person who's the managing agent for the property and is in charge of the maintenance. So we have had a problem in dealing with certain properties within the town where it's taken a tremendous amount of effort to track down the actual person or persons or entity that are responsible for maintaining these properties. And hopefully that will make our job easier. And there are fees involved. We'll have to pass a fee schedule. I've given you a copy of the fee schedule that Beacon has adopted. Doesn't mean that we have to adopt the same one, but I'd like you to take a look at that. And we have certain provisions for the exemption of the registration fee if an open valid building permit is being pursued with diligence. So if we have a situation where you have a property and they're working with our zoning administrator or building inspector to put the property to use, we would exempt them from the fee. Again, we have a provision requiring if the owner does not reside within a 15-mile radius of the town of Hyde Park, we want that property owner to designate a managing agent. That's part of the law so that there's somebody that we can communicate with in cases of problems with a property. Again, notification of changes to vacant building registration statement. It's incumbent on the property owner if there's a change in the status of the building to notify us. And we have a provision for enforcement, reimbursement of funds expended. If we have to expend funds in enforcing this agreement, we can charge that back to the property. And we have a penalty assessment provision and penalties for offenses if you violate the law. So again, this is just a first shot at it. If in between now and the next meeting, if any of the board members just want to email me with their comments, I don't want to open a dialogue, but if you can tell me if you have any problems, and then we can discuss it after you've had a chance to look at it at the next meeting.
Could I just, the only thing I would just suggest maybe everyone could think about was whether this is something we would want to apply to residential buildings as well as commercial. I think right now it's both. I think the main problem that we're concerned with in Hyde Park is commercial buildings. And I'm not, that's just something maybe for people to think about, whether extending it to residential is desirable or not.
But I can tell you we've had problems with residential.
Yeah, I was going to say residential, you know, with the foreclosures that can sit.
But I'm wondering if it would really actually be a tremendous tool with the foreclosures.
We've had, what's happening now is that people are, properties being foreclosed upon, where the banks are really taking controls of property, and these banks are very difficult to locate. If you do enough work and track it down, sometimes you are lucky and you get a hold of somebody who will listen to your complaints and respond to you. But I can tell you, we've had a couple of instances where it took a great amount of effort to do that. And those are residential properties. So it's an issue that we should consider, but I'm probably going to encourage you to apply it to residential properties also.
I guess I was just mainly concerned about the administration and, you know, our bandwidth to take this on. And then also, you know, the fees, which I guess could be differential for the different types of.
I think why it would work very well, though, with the foreclosed properties is because it would then often be the banks that are subject to the fees if they've actually taken them right? But as Warren said, that's one of our biggest difficulties in enforcing the property maintenance law or, you know, building violations is finding the owner in so many of the foreclosed properties. And I don't know how, so if a property hadn't yet been foreclosed on, but it was still in the name of the property owner, this would then accrue to that property owner?
Well, there's another circumstance where it has not been foreclosed upon. There's a mortgage on the property. The property is rented to people who have no idea who the owner is, have no contact, and have no responsibility for the property. But in many of those cases, the banks do have a designated segment of their enterprise which deals with these properties to ensure that they're kept up to speed so that when they do foreclose, the properties have some value. And again, it's been difficult to track those down. This would require that information so that we have that. So those would be cases where it hasn't been foreclosed upon, but we don't know who's really administering the property.
Right. I think the state is attempting to address this through zombie legislation. I haven't followed it that carefully.
I'm sure Annapolis is big on it.
So. Yeah. They adopted that.
Oh, yeah. They did? Mm-hmm. Yeah, which enables fines to accrue to properties that are just, haven't been foreclosed yet, but are in the process of it. Is that how it's operating?
Sure.
I think maybe.
Yeah, I'm not.
Yeah. We might want to just take a look at that,
though. We will take a look at it
to see how that
applies.
Should be part of that.
Sure.
I'm confused on the tax issues, too. Our taxes, they're not paid. Somebody foreclosed, they leave the house. Who pays the taxes, the county and the town? Do they go unpaid?
The bank usually pays the taxes. The bank will be notified. In the event that property is in danger of being foreclosed for non-payment of taxes.
Right.
And the in-rem proceedings, I think, allow 3 years to accrue before the county takes over. So what they do is they notify the county notifies everybody who may have some interest in that property. They actually, if you have a filed judgment against the property, they'll send that to you also.
Okay.
And give the bank and the banks, but a lot of the banks are well aware of the situation, and then they'll come in and they'll pay the taxes so that the property doesn't get sold at a foreclosure sale.
But I think a lot of people don't realize that the county makes the towns whole.
It does.
Okay, so even if a property is vacant, like the one across the street, we still collect tax dollars on it because the town submits our complete tax roll to the county. They pay us up front, and then we pay back the county over the year. And that's why if you have a delinquent payment, after a certain length of time, you pay directly to the county.
I understand that, but does that continue to go on, or is there a limit to the county?
Well, no matter who owns it, the taxes are due. So
the county does make us whole.
The county makes us whole.
Makes us whole, but
The problem still exists.
The problem still exists, and the taxpayers of the municipality still pay for this through their county taxes.
Right.
So it's not a free ride.
Right.
It helps the municipality because we get the tax dollars from the county, but ultimately the burden is placed upon the citizens of the communities through their county taxes to pay that. And
I think maybe what you're asking, though, Dave, if I understand you, is that when a property is foreclosed on, is that what your question is then? The
you mean bank foreclosure or tax foreclosure?
Bank foreclosure.
Bank, okay.
The taxes remain. That's the one thing that's not wiped out, right?
That is not wiped out.
A tax lien and a federal tax lien, so that gets paid.
Yeah. If you buy it at a foreclosure sale, you buy it subject to those taxes.
You still owe it.
You're buying a I understand that's included in that. But they continue to make it whole, but as Warren said, the taxpayers pay anyway.
Yeah.
Plus, the value of the property around them goes down all the time.
Absolutely.
Which really hurts.
It absolutely has. Yeah. So I think that we'll explore it more and look forward to hearing from the gentleman down here.
Yeah, I mean, I just had I read through this briefly, and I know that you and I and the zoning and building department has been working diligently with some property maintenance issues recently. This law looks great, but this law is only as good as the enforcement we give it.
Yeah.
And, you know, we have, we're really cut to the quick here already. And for this, I'm sure for this to work well in Beacon, they must have had a pretty good code enforcement officer.
They have more staff. I mean, they're a city despite, I think they're only 13,000 people, which is 9,000 people less than the town of Hyde Park. But being a city, they have a lot more
resources.
Benefit of, yes. And so I think that's a very valid point.
Right.
As how will we have the resources to be administered?
Which I think is great. So I think, you know, I hate always increasing and going over the tax cap and things like that, but I think, you know, this is becoming more and more of an important issue, I think, for this town board and the residents of town of Hyde Park. If we really are going to seriously look at something like this, we already have a lot of laws that are on our books that we have a hard time enforcing.
Yep.
And just to add more on there and then not enforce it doesn't make any sense either.
It's a valid point.
So I think as a town board, if we're looking at this type of enforcement, we should really look at how are we going to enforce it.
Right.
And if we're serious about doing something like this, then we really have to look deeply into our budget to try to figure out how to really enforce these laws.
Very well said.
And we should get of course, we'll get the input of Tad and our building inspector. They can look at the law and then they can give us their comments and thoughts on this process too. But yes, I can tell you it will be an added, you know, financial burden to enforce this law for sure. That's
But it does, there is some registration fee that offsets
it should offset it.
I saw that. I'm just going through my head, okay, if somebody has a vacant building, how do we even enforce doing that fee? You know, how does that
how
happen?
How do you, if they don't comply, well, right. Then it would probably be through the justice court process.
Well, it can be a civil penalty. We can bring them into criminal court. It's the same way we would enforce anything and any other law. And ultimately, it would be charged back against
But what the would law. Trigger the fee, I guess? Like, so if I had a vacant building for 6 months, what triggers them paying that fee? What would trigger that?
Are you saying, would you send them a letter? Is that what you, or?
Right, I mean,
or
so how would Tad or the building department even know that there's a vacant building?
Right.
Without having a code enforcement officer on the street
saying
kind of policing it, you know what I mean? I mean, I don't know how else they would know.
Mm-hmm.
I get a lot of calls personally.
Of course.
Dave's going to do it.
I mean, in the ward, you know.
Yeah.
Of course.
I mean, a lot of these are buildings.
I'm sure Aileen does too.
That will be brought to our attention. It may already be brought to our attention. Mm-hmm. But this doesn't mean that every vacant building in town will automatically, within 90 days of the law, be put on the register. I mean, that's going to be a slow process. And probably as we hear about properties that are vacant that haven't registered, they'll be sent a notice that they're, you know, they have to register.
I mean, I think it's great. I'm just trying to figure out the enforcement of it.
The details. The devil's in that.
Correct.
Yeah. Okay.
Great. Thank you. Appreciate that.
Keep working on it?
Yeah, absolutely.
Oh, yeah. I think the town board has the, we have to have the will to do it.
Well, yeah, I mean, it's, there's an aspect to zoning that is based on compliance and the desire to comply to be part of a community. And it is very difficult for everyone to know. Like I said earlier, zoning is a very obtuse subject. It's not easy for the average person to understand. And, you know, I forget, I guess Joe just asked that question, you know, how do people know what is the right thing to do, right? I think you met with some constituents and they were hoping that there was a takeaway brochure on exactly what you're supposed to do to be a good citizen. But, you know, like you said, Joe, a lot of it is common sense, you know?
Do you think Randy would be willing to come for a workshop?
You know, I don't know. I mean, we could ask him, but yeah.
I mean, I think it's...
I mean, I think you kind of nailed it, though, in terms of the enforcement is the difficult part. But, you know, we did add a new fire inspector to the town's personnel list, and he has been hard at work compiling the list of properties to do the fire inspections on. And I think that, you know, it's partially just getting this into a more systematic groove. I mean, we have, so, you know, a lot of it is definitely personnel, but we also now have a zoning prosecutor, and that's the second step of these things. Like, as you say, if you just send violations without any, without any repercussions, then what good is that? So, you know, that was something we did several years ago, and that's been successful. And the third prong of attack was acquiring new software that would allow us to track and, you know, track the enforcement of these violations. And, you know, it's still all a work in progress. Yeah. Some of the software is not what we had hoped it would be, and it turns out that it's really in development, unfortunately. Like, we were expecting a finished product, but it turns out that they're really developing it as they go along, which was a bit of a disappointment. But that is still, will prove, I think, to be valuable, so.
Good.
But, okay, well, thanks. So then, Warren's been a very busy attorney here, because we now have a third workshop item, and that is the wedding and other special events local law discussion. That's our third workshop. And to lead into this, how this developed, you know, there have been, the people in Statsburg in particular have been aware that there's a property that is used for wedding venues, as a wedding venue. And, you know, the town doesn't really have anything in their zoning that deals with that or, you know, alludes to that, really. So, you know, we've worked with the town attorney to look at other communities, how they've legislated that. Essentially, you know, we have a couple of properties throughout town that lend themselves to wedding venue type uses. And what we'd like to do is find a way to legitimize those uses and control them to make sure that they're safe and that they're controlled and that they're bona fide. So Warren has been working with Victoria Polidoro, our planning board attorney, on crafting a law that would address these uses and enable the town to assure that these are used properly and safely. So, Warren, I don't know if you kind of want to go over.
Yeah, I'll go over. this is you described it perfectly. These are this is a hot button issue in many communities now. And I'm not talking about the occasional use of someone's private property for a wedding for a friend or a relative. I mean, we're talking about properties that are being used for commercial purposes, for wedding venues where they rent out the property and have large scale events on a fairly common basis, especially during the summer. And many municipalities have been enacting amendments to the zoning law to provide for these uses. And when we heard about the problem with at least one property, we realized that there was nothing in our zoning law which specifically permitted property to be used in this manner for commercial purposes for a wedding venue. So we looked at some other laws that we were familiar with, and came up with a first draft. Again, this is a first draft because there's even some questions in this draft that Victoria primarily worked on for us. Some questions about standards for parking and some other issues. But basically, it defines what a special event venue is, and it's been described in this draft as an establishment where gatherings and events such as, but not limited to, wedding parties, weddings, parties, fundraisers, small conferences, and similar events are held for compensation, subject to the supplemental standards set forth in Article 28. And we have set forth some supplemental standards which require that you have a certain minimum amount of 5 acres. The initial draft has 5 acres as the minimum, and 2 means of ingress and egress, able to accommodate parking on site, adequate potable water and potable sanitary systems, buffers for neighboring properties, allowing an event to occur in an event barn if there is an event barn, and that's quite popular, where old barns are being converted to event barns to have weddings. The problem is that those barns do not meet code standards for having these types of gatherings. So we're going to make sure that if an event barn is used, that it meets the code requirements and protect the health, safety, and welfare of the community and the people who attend these events. We have prohibitions on when it can start and when it has to terminate. We require an event management plan and submit it to the town board for review. And we're anticipating that would happen is that we would have a site plan review for this type of use, which would require the applicant, the property owner, to come before the planning board and deal with all of these issues, and then would permit the events to occur so that they wouldn't have to come back each time they have an event for another permit. So again, this is a this is our first shot at it, so we're providing this to you for you to look at and provide us with your input on this, and hopefully by the time we get to the next meeting, we can all be able to discuss this intelligently and decide if this is something we want to move forward with.
And I don't know that we made it very clear that this would apply in the waterfront and Greenbelt.
Oh, I'm sorry. Only in those districts.
Only in those districts, because it wouldn't apply in neighborhood or neighborhood business or and in general commercial. This type of use would be allowed. So it wouldn't, it's not really applicable, because that would be a permitted use under our regular code. So really it's just the waterfront and Greenbelt districts. And it's particularly relevant to the waterfront district because of this part of our comprehensive plan in our code, which encourages the use for water dependent and water enhanced uses, including recreation and tourism. So the emphasis of this law is to allow those uses to exist, but still retain the emphasis on open space and quality of life. So I think that, you know, it's an attempt to bring into the fold uses that are not currently permitted and control them to make sure that the, as you say, public health and safety are protected.
Correct. You're right.
And this one in particular, you know, it has brought there's been a lot of attention paid to it, but there are other places in town that in the Greenbelt where I've been approached by different property owners and saying that, you know, they'd like to be able to do possibly a venue there, so. So, again, I don't know, Em, do you have any thoughts here?
I think it's great. I mean, I think it's a useful way to have a public open process through the planning board where if someone wants to have this type of use, that neighbors and people who live in the area would be able to come in and know about what's going on and have their input considered and have proper restrictions put on to ensure that parking and noise and other other issues don't affect the neighbors. So I think we're on the right track. And I just think we need to clarify, you know, that it doesn't, I think as Warren mentioned, it does not apply, it would not apply to just someone having a single or occasional event at their own home, even having a fundraiser or things. This is when it's a consistent use that is commercial in nature and that money is exchanged. And it also wouldn't, I don't think it would be a new regulation on places like firehouses or libraries or places that already have events because they already have a site plan and they already have, you know, allowed uses on those sites. So this is really, I think, intended for properties that are not otherwise commercial or institutional in nature that want to be able to use that property for special event use.
Great.
Yeah. Does anyone else have any thoughts or comments?
Nope.
Okay.
I do. I think Emily answered it. But so if you have a private property and you decide to have these events and make money on them, that's what we're talking about.
Yeah.
We're not talking about somebody's graduation.
No,
party,
not at all. No.
Even though it may
not
be in
for
a district.
Personal use.
Right. Okay.
Not necessarily make money, but charge money.
Well, yes.
The key word is for compensation.
Right.
If you're renting it out, basically.
Yeah. Right.
Yeah. Yep. And I'm glad that you brought up the existing uses at firehouses, and because they often do have events. Yeah. So it would not apply in those circumstances. Okay.
So, right, if, so again, what's if our you next have, step you, with this? I'd like you to look it over.
Yeah.
If as you read it, if you have any questions for me, just email me. Okay. But again, we're not going to engage in a dialogue. And internally, we're going to be chewing into this a little bit more, and then hopefully by the next meeting, we might come back with a more finished product if we decide we want to move forward with this.
Great.
And if anyone in Statsburg who might be watching has any comments, you can feel free to contact me directly.
Great. Okay. So moving on now to the public comment on the resolutions only. Does anyone have anything that they would like to let us know? Okay, so then why don't we move on to the resolutions?
Resolution 591 of 2016, resolution authorizing the town engineer to obtain survey data and drafting of plans for Dinsmore Park basketball court improvement project.
Second.
And all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. So Pete, you're here. How is that coming, that project? Do we?
We preempted a little bit. I made the assumption that the resolution would pass tonight.
Good.
So we did the survey.
Okay.
And I met with Kathleen today.
Okay.
And so we outlined everything, and I told her that I would have a draft plan for her to look at probably the end of the week. And then probably, I believe the town clerk's already authorized to advertise for bids. That was done already. So I told her within a couple of weeks, we should be able to get that out for bid.
Can I just ask you, how was the bid designed? Is it just one bid or add alternates? Because we have this special product, right, that we're
special. That's what they wanted to use.
Yeah, I know. And then we also have fencing. And some other preparations, right?
Yeah, that's a good, I hadn't thought about that, but we would probably, because you wouldn't get the same person who's going to do the court to do the fence. So, you know, that's a good point. I hadn't really thought that far ahead, because obviously if we put it all in one, then they're going to have to hire a sub, mark it up. So we could probably do the fence under a little quickie. You know, separate bid, okay. That's pretty easy. And
then we'd be more likely to get local fence
yeah,
people.
Sure.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yep. Yep. But if you'd like to review anything yet, before it goes out, I'm more than happy to sit down with anybody on the board. Maybe we don't need to do it at a meeting here, but if we could do it in the office or something like that, that's fine.
Well, I guess the other...
Or we could do it here at a meeting, it's fine too, whatever.
I guess my other question is, so we have this product, this specific product that we're...
The sport court.
Sport court, that's right.
So is there more than one source where you can buy that, or...
The way I understand it, yes, you know, there is. I mean, there's not a ton, but it's not necessarily a sole source. And there is, from what I understand, there is qualified installers within our general, you know, like, area. Again, it's not any contractors going to be able to come in, I can do this, because you have to have, you know, the training, whatever training that you need, because in order to get the warranty on the product, they want you to have a certified installer to keep, you know, your warranty. So, you know, I'm told there are some installers in New York, in this general area, you know, Connecticut, within, you know, a reasonable, you know, driving distance, so.
Okay, good. So we'll put that up on BidNet, and we'll advertise.
Yeah, but we can sit down and go over it. If Joe wants to sit down, because I think you're, you know, the liaison right to the Rec Commission, so.
It's just a very big investment. I think we're looking about $60,000.
That's what Kathleen had estimated, yeah.
And, you know, that was a decision that the Rec Commission made, and...
That's correct.
It's just a very big investment in one small area, so I want to make sure that we try to get the best...
Bang for our buck. Yeah, I understand.
I mean, I'm extremely happy that there's going to be a nice park down in Emily's Ward. I mean, that Statsburg area really needs something. I'm just not sure about that sport court, that's all.
Yeah, I know you expressed reservations on it, but that was the decision the Rec Commission made, so... Okay. Well, as long as you're here, though, before we move on, do you have an update on the Green Tree Corner? I know that Emily's people have been asking.
Well, how much of an update do you want me to...
I mean, I think the brief update, right, is that we did authorize the contractor to get started, but he had a little delay in terms of the asbestos remediation and needing some additional...
Yeah, he needs some additional time, because the problem came in that the demolition contractor came down and visited the site before he put in his bid. His asbestos subcontractor did not come down and visit the site because they felt it was too small of a job. So the asbestos subcontractor excuse me, was going to do the job one way. And when I got a hold of the air monitor that we needed to take, you know, the air samples, he said, no, you can't, like, do it that way because of the condition of the roof. So to make a long story short, I think it'll all work out fine. And they've applied for a variance to the New York State Department of Labor, which will basically let them demolish the entire roof as one hazardous waste, that so they would classify, which is really the way that you would think they would have done it anyways, because the roof is in pretty bad shape. So, you know, the subcontractor had thought that he would basically come in, send his guys up there on, you know, the roof and take care of the, like, asbestos. And once he found out that the condition of the roof was not safe to send, you know, his men up there, they had to go in a different, like, direction. So there'll probably be about I'm going to find out some more, but possibly like a 30-day lag. And because they've applied for the variance, we should get it. It should probably come in the next couple of weeks. And so we had a little, you know, blip.
We'll get there someday. Thank you for staying on top of it. I know it was extra work for you.
No, that's fine. And, you know, I'm learning a lot in the, you know, asbestos world. Is you know, it's complicated. There's a lot of things that you would think that you should be able to do, but you just can't do it. I'm finding that out on, you know, another job too that we're working on. It's never as easy as you think it is.
I think it's taking about 10 times as long to remove that building as it took to build it in the first place.
Yeah. Yeah.
I think you're probably right.
But we'll get there, and and I'll give you, you know, an update. It's just kind of unfortunate the way it happened, but it'll happen.
Well, it's an unusual project.
In so many ways.
Unique.
Great way to...
So, yeah, we appreciate you keeping it...
That's fine, no problem.
Keeping track of it, Pete. Okay, great. Thank you. Okay.
I don't think we did two yet.
No, we didn't do, that was just the first one.
You voted on the first one.
Right.
Okay. Resolution 59-2 of 2016. Resolution approving budget revisions to the town of Hyde Park for the period of April 2016. Budget revisions number 2016-04.
Second.
And all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
I just wanted to point out one thing on the budget revisions. So I think you remember that when the highway superintendent came a month or so ago, we talked about a number of things, but one was whether additional money could be dedicated towards drainage this year. And so I did sit down with both TC and with Walt, and we determined that we could take $10,000 from the snow removal overtime that we didn't need this past winter and transfer that into drainage repair. So hopefully that will enable the highway crew to have the tools to do more of the drainage projects that they need to do this summer.
Yep, that was, we were very fortunate to have such a light winter, leaving us with some extra funds for the drainage, and thanks for pointing that out. And I don't know if most people realize this, because I certainly didn't, that the way a budget works, if you have an expenditure, increase in expenditure, then you do have to decrease in expenditure somewhere else. So that's why every month we have budget revisions,
right,
moving the money around, essentially.
Okay. Resolution 59-3 of 2016, resolution accepting a donation from Hyde Park Lions Club for music in the parks.
Okay, well, that worked out good. Well, Joe, you're the liaison there. If everybody looks behind their resolution, do you have any backup there?
No.
No. So we're still working on that. That was supposed to be part of your packet.
Just from the Lions.
But so this resolution is accepting a donation from the Lions Club for Music in the Parks. And I just had asked Kathleen if she could prepare description of what the costs are and who we and what we have collected thus far. So the contracts for the Music in the Parks are about $5,900. And so we have, let's see, how many? We have 12 bands. We have 12 evenings of it. And we have thus far collected donations, I believe, of $200 from the Lions and certain amount from the Rotary. I'm not sure how much, but it's a pretty expensive endeavor for us. Actually, AARP donated 100, the Knights of Columbus donated 50, and now the Lions has donated 200. And as you can see, it's the $5,900 in contracts plus another at least $1,000 in staffing. So it's kind of, it's a definitely a very wonderful and valuable program for the town. But I don't think most people realize that that's actually one place that your tax dollars go. So I just wanted to point that out. Okay, so do we have a second to accept the donation? And all in favor?
Aye.
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 And also, I know in years past, we've had an institution give us some money. And it's a little bit difficult, too, because, you know, when we're on the national parks grounds, we can't have any banners or anything there. So it's kind of hard for some businesses because they there's no signage, you know, at each one. So it makes it a little bit difficult, too.
Yeah, the national park prohibits that.
Correct.
But the state park allows it, or
State park really doesn't allow signs. You can sell things there, so like the lion sells baked goods and things like that. You can't even do that on the National Park Service. You can't even have a bake sale there.
So it's not, they don't really get much back for that nice contribution. Well, we definitely appreciated it, and from Rhinebeck Bank. So
right, yeah. I mean, we really tried, you know, in the beginning, you know, mentioning them and all that.
Yeah, yeah.
It's a little difficult.
But we appreciate what they did give. Okay, so...
To the resolution.
Yep, resolution number four.
Resolution 59-4 of 2016. Resolution of scheduling a public hearing on the 2016 MS4 permit annual report for May 23rd, 2016.
And second, and all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Resolution 595 of 2016, resolution recognizing ambulance service agreement, Town of Pleasant Valley and Mobile Life Support Services for the Quaker Lane Ambulance District.
Second.
And all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Resolution 59-6 of 2016, resolution authorizing police officers Sean Phillips and Jacqueline Tucker to attend a one-day training session inducted by Calabre Press entitled Warrior's Edge.
And all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Resolution 59-7 of 2016, resolution authorizing renewal of a used motor vehicle license for the time period between January 1, 2000 and December 31, 2016.
And a second?
Second.
And all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Glad they've collected 16 years of fees.
I was like, yeah, is that right?
They slid, yeah. I know.
They slid for a little while.
16 years.
I was in court.
All right.
Yeah.
Resolution 59-8 of 2016. Resolution authorizing zoning administrator to attend the New York State Floodplain and Stormwater Managers Association annual meeting on May 16th, 2016 through May 18th, 2016.
And a second?
Second.
And all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Resolution 599 of 2016, resolution authorizing the town clerk to publish a notice of filing the annual financial report, nunc pro tunc.
Second.
And all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Resolution 59-10 of 2016, resolution authorizing a reclassification in the general fund from unassigned fund balance to assigned fund balance.
This is a very exciting resolution. I hope everybody reads it, especially the last paragraph. But we collected $200,000 more in sales tax last year. And so that's just very exciting because we really, as you mentioned, manage everything to the dollar. And all our estimates are always conservative. So we were very fortunate to receive an additional sales tax distribution. So, you know, our own law, town law, requires us to keep between 5% and 10%, I believe it is, that we're not allowed to have more than 8% in our general fund balance. So what TC and I talked about is creating an assigned fund balance that would be for future tax stabilization and capital projects. So these monies will be designated for that, for either, you know, as we said, capital projects, something that the town needs to do in the future, you know, a reval or a new roof or, you know, new, you know, salt, yeah, or, you know, a match for a grant, or in order to keep the tax rate down. And so that's what this is about. And may I have a second?
Second.
Okay. And all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
And then when we want to use it, there, that would be a resolution.
It would be a resolution that that
probably subject to press of referendum.
Yeah, when it is used.
Good. So I just have a quick question. Maybe this is something I should just ask TC. When we do something like this, and then we also have like a snow fund, you know, reserve that we have, which is not part of our fund balance, but it does show, you know, our strength physically,
yeah,
right?
Yeah.
So it does show that we have, so we could be at maybe 5% for our fund balance, which would be kind of low,
right?
But yet we could have all these reserves
assigned, yeah.
That's what's been happening. The assigned fund balances, we're really getting some nice conservative funds for the various
right.
things that might come up.
Okay. And that was something that TC instituted, and it is what the comptroller recommends, is having these designated funds within your fund balance.
Right,
and
for retirees,
right, for the snow fund. And then, so this is just really creating another one. So it wasn't actually just the sales tax, but we did collect additional mortgage tax, and that was also contributing to the fund.
Great. I just want to correct myself, that expenditures from that would not require a permissive referendum.
Oh, really?
But just a resolution.
Oh, okay.
Because not a capital reserve fund.
Oh, okay.
Okay, resolution 59-11 of 2016, resolution authorizing the town clerk and highway superintendent to solicit blacktop bids for the 2016 road construction season.
Second.
And all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
And that'll be for Rogers Road, Kobe Road, Quailridge Road, and Christie Lane.
I think that's for.
Okay, great. And that is with our CHIPS funding, and I did speak with the Association of Towns, and they are creating a new program. They did not increase CHIPS at all, but they are creating a new program, Pave New York and Bridge New York, and so they have designated certain amount of funds in the state budget, but they have to create the language to allow it to be used. So we may be getting some additional funds for paving. And also, our county executive has created an additional shared service program, which is oriented towards doing funding capital projects that will enable towns to stay under the tax cap. So we're going to be working on a number of those applications, and it seemed like perhaps the roof or the salt shed might be a good application. So that's of interest, and hopefully there will be some more tools for us to try to improve the paving of the roads, because there just has not been enough money for that. And then I just wanted to mention also that tomorrow night we're having an open house at the Hackett House.
Yeah.
Right, Joe? And
yeah.
And what's that going to be? Is it just
it's going to be anyone who hasn't seen the Hackett House since it's been renovated, it's a chance to come and see what's been done and have a tour and just, you know, ask any questions you would want to
yeah.
of what the Rec Commission does or the Hackett House or anything like that.
Great.
It's a beautiful home.
Yeah,
it
it's
is,
beautiful.
Yeah,
it
and,
did a great job.
You know, that was a lot of primarily done, or a big portion of it was done with monies from the Kenneen Hackett Foundation. So yeah. They've been invited to come too.
Yes, they have. Yeah.
Okay, so can I have a motion to, well, is there anyone who would like to speak on any town-related item? Okay, so may I have a motion to close the meeting?
Motion.
And a second?
Second.
And all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay, good night.
I had a real long one last year.
Oh, okay. Do you want to just do it?
Take
everything. You want to? Yes. Yeah, well, let's just do it. Yeah, I think it's a great way to.
Yeah, we'll get.
Walking the.